Shravan, you can start whenever, maybe.
Yeah, sorry. I can begin. Pashwati, can I do the introduction?
Sure, go ahead.
Yeah, it's my pleasure to introduce Professor Jørgen Christensen-Dalsgaard today. He's a giant, as it were, in the fields of astroseismology and helioseismology, having had pole position and seen, you know, sat through many of the most dramatic developments in these two fields. And more recently, he actually visited our department several months earlier. And so we've, you know, the entire department has also had a chance to meet with him and speak with him and so on. Jørgen is very distinguished. He got his PhD with Professor Douglas Goff in Cambridge. And then after that, his career seen a meteoric rise. He was he's now a faculty member at the Aarhus University in Denmark. He's been at the forefront of every single major seismology mission, or, you know, solar and stellar mission, so thus far, maybe not one or two, sorry, so almost every single major mission, and now is leading an effort actually to create a ground-based stellar observatory that will have multiple nodes across the globe to continuously monitor the sky, and so that will be a very exciting, I believe it's still in progress, so when it's completed, will be very exciting and provide us with excellent data. He's, you know, he's a member of some of the most important committees that decide on various things such as space missions and directions of research and so on. And, you know, he's a member of the Royal Danish Academy of Science and Letters. I have one question. So it says you're an honorary fellow of the Royal Society. Does that mean you're a fellow of the Royal Society?
No. This is the Royal Astronomical Society.
Oh, I see. Oh, it's not the Royal Society. Okay.
No. I hope there's not a misprint in my CV.
But it's just a matter of time, I'm sure, before he does become a fellow. He's given very important lectures in a number of important places. I've had the pleasure myself of meeting him periodically in a number of meetings over the past several years. Always a pleasure, always a little bit of humor in his talks, certainly very deep excursions into the physics of the sun and stars. So thanks a lot, Jørgen, for agreeing to this and, you know, providing us with the opportunity to listen to you again. So with that, I'm done. So please proceed.
Thank you, Shravan, for this introduction.
My apologies, I forgot to mention one thing. Jørgen has mentioned that he would like to answer questions at the end. So for those of you who do have questions, I don't want you to forget them. So please put them down in the chat box. And so once the talk is done, I'll go through the chat box and we can answer all of the questions that you have. So with that, I'm sorry to interrupt. Yeah.
Okay, fine. So thank you for this invitation. I'm very sorry not to be in Mumbai in person. It's been too long since I spent time there. But I really enjoyed my time, and I miss the sunset walks along the sea. So what I want to talk today about today is what we learned about red giants from astroseismic observations, mainly from the Kepler mission. And as an introduction, just let me remind you what a star looks like, at least the model of a star. We have the energy generation in the core, in the solar case, from hydrogen fusion. We have a radiated transport in part of the star. And then in cool stars like the sun and the stars I'm going to talk about today, we have an outer convection zone with gas motion taking energy out to the surface. Now, the red giants I'm going to talk about are in an evolved stage of evolution, and we can schematically illustrate that in this way. We have solar-like stars like the sun with central hydrogen burning, then converting hydrogen into helium, so we end up with having used up all the helium in the core. Then we have a phase with a hydrogen-burning shell around a helium core. And then later we get ignition of helium fusion at the center of the star. Then we're still in the helium core. And we still have the hydrogen burning shell surrounding that helium core. So the way that looks in the properties of a star is illustrated here in the diagram of the effective temperature and luminosity of the star, starting on the main sequence with the hydrogen burning. Then as we move into the hydrogen shell burning phase, the star moves up the red giant branch. So we have the helium core and the hydrogen shell. And then at the top of the red giant branch, in the solar case with a luminosity more than 1,000 times the present solar luminosity, we get ignition of the helium burning, and then the star settles down in a core helium burning phase in what observationally is known as a red clump. And then there's further evolution where with helium shell burning and mass loss and the evolution towards the white dwarf stage. And so basically we have a star growing in size, losing mass, and ending up as a white dwarf surrounded by a planetary nebula for a very short time. So these are all these wonderful models we have of the star. But the question is, how do we know all this? And what do we really know about stars in the sense of being able to observe it? And then things are a bit more restricted. We can observe the surface temperature of the star. We can observe the composition of the surface to some extent. For some stars, we can observe the radius. We have some measure of surface gravity. If we know the distance to the star, we have a measure of luminosity. We have some ways of determining the mass of stars. But measuring the internal properties of stars is very difficult. And that was noted already by Sir Arthur Stanley Eddington. And he wrote a wonderful book that you should all read. It's not quite all right now, but he made the point that at first sight, it would seem that the deep interior of sun and stars is less accessible to scientific investigation than any other region of the universe, simply because we can't see beyond the surface layers of a star. And so he ended up by asking the question, what appliance can test conditions within a star? And his answer to that was modeling, which he then excelled in. But now we actually do have the tools to measure the conditions in the interior of star. We have astroseismology. And what we are doing here is to use observations of stellar oscillations as probes of stellar interiors. And they are wonderful probes because we can measure oscillation frequencies with very high precision. And the frequencies that we obtain in this way are very sensitive to the internal structure and rotation of the star. And then we can also study mode amplitudes and in that way learn about the physics of the near surface layers of the star. And that is really what I'm going to be talking about today. So to do that, we have to understand a little bit about the properties of stellar oscillations. And we can separate that into three different levels: the basic geometry of the oscillations, the dynamics of the oscillations, and then the way the oscillations are excited. Now, the geometry of oscillations of a spherically symmetric star, and the stars I'm going to talk about today are largely spherically symmetric, can be described in terms of spherical harmonics. The normal modes of a spherical body are described in terms of spherical harmonics. And the main thing here is really just to note that there are these different geometries of the surface oscillations of stars. I haven't illustrated here the most boring ones, the radial oscillation, where the star just keeps the spherical symmetry and grows and expands and contracts. And then they're most characterized by these different wave numbers, the degree L and the azimuthal order M. L counts the total number of nodes in the stellar surface. M counts how many nodes there are around the equator. So we have L of one, dipolar modes, two, the modes that are zonal, and sectoral modes, three, and then all the higher degree modes, which we can't see in distant stars, because all what we observe is just the integrated light across the stellar surface. In the sun, they're very important. In distant stars, we are constrained just to look at the low degree modes. So that's the geometry. Then dynamics, that's a matter of the restoring forces in the star. And we have basically two restoring forces at work. One is pressure, and that sets up acoustic modes that are basically standing sound waves. They tend to have fairly high frequency. They depend on the sound speed in the star mainly. And in the low degree modes we're looking at here, they extend all the way to the center of the star. And the second class of modes, these are what we observe in the sun. In the second class of modes are standing internal gravity waves, not gravitational waves. These are waves driven by buoyancy. They have fairly low frequency, certainly in the sun. And they depend on the buoyancy frequency, which again is very sensitive to the composition profile in the star. In the sun, we may see examples of this. That's very controversial. But these internal gravity waves are actually well known also from the Earth's atmosphere. This is as an example from the sky above Copenhagen, where we see these waves in the cloud layers caused by these internal gravity waves controlling where the vapor condenses and from clouds. And this is also what we see in internal gravity waves in the oceans and in stars. And then finally, to see the oscillations, we need to excite them. And there are basically two ways of doing that. One is to have the modes be intrinsically unstable. That is what works in high amplitude pulsating stars like Cepheids. And the second mechanism is to have a way to kick intrinsically stable modes by external forcing. And that is really what I'm going to be talking about today. Stable modes driven stochastically by the acoustic noise from near surface convection. Remember, we had this convection energy transport near the surface of the star, and that excites noise, and that noise then excites the stable mode, the resonance stable modes in the star to what we observe. So to use these modes, we have to observe them. And again, for the solar-like oscillations, these stable modes excited by acoustic noise, they tend to have very low amplitudes in the sun, below 1 meter per second. In rate velocity, in intensity, a few parts per million. And they can be observed both in rate velocity and in intensity. In rate velocity, because the amplitude is so small, we observe one star at a time. In intensity, and that's what I'm going to be talking about today, we can observe stars photometrically in images of the sky, and so we can observe many stars simultaneously. But again, we have this issue that we have to observe signals that are very, very small. Now, to do that, we have to, we need very sensitive instruments, and also to observe the details of the frequency spectrum, we need to observe for a very long time, ideally years. And we also need nearly continuous data. And the simplest, in some sense, way of doing that is to observe from space. And the issue there, of course, is to get somebody to pay a few million, hundreds of millions of dollars to send up a spacecraft to do these observations. And to do that, you need a really sexy subject. Stellar oscillations are fantastic. and they have been used as arguments for space missions. But what really sold the space missions that we're using was the potential to find planets around other stars. And one way to do that is to look for the signal you get when a planet passes in front of a star, because it hides a little bit of the surface of the star and causes a small decrease in the luminosity of the star. To see that, if this were the Earth passing in front of the Sun, you have to measure a signal at a level of one part in 10,000. And if you measure a signal of that magnitude, then you can also see the very regular oscillations at a level of a few parts per million. And this convinced NASA to develop the Kepler mission, with the main goal to see these exoplanets. And Kepler was amazingly successful in doing that. They basically demonstrated that essentially all main sequence stars of solar type in the galaxy have one or more planets around it. But it also was a fantastic mission to look for stellar oscillations. So the goals of Kepler was to find planets. Doing that, observing a large field, 100 square degrees, is roughly the area of your hand if you stretch it out. Observing a very large number of stars, 150,000 stars simultaneously, most of them with observing integrating over 30 minutes, but about 500 stars were observed with a 1 minute cadence. And it succeeded doing that for 4 years. Here's the mission in the lab before it was launched. It's about a 1 meter diameter slit telescope with a large set of detectors in the middle of the telescope tube, with solar rays and then controlled by reaction wheels to keep the very precise pointing towards the sun, or towards the one part of the sky. It observed just one area for the 4 years. It was launched in March 2009. I was there to see the launch. My first launch, the launch was from Cape Canaveral and was, of course, very exciting. All worked. And it had an estimated lifetime of 4 years. The guarantee ran out after 4 years, and so did the reaction wheels. And so that ended the nominal mission. And the data I'm going to be talking about today were from this 4 year nominal mission. It continued for another few years in a different mode, which produced very interesting results, but not quite so useful for these studies of red giants. So the playing field, the astroseismic playing field for Kepler and all these other studies, in the Hertzsprung-Russell diagram are all these stars that show pulsations. And Kepler basically observed all of them. But the stars I'm going to focus on today are the ones that show solar-like oscillations. So fairly cool stars, main sequence stars, and red giants. And what we expect to see for these stars is what we have seen from the sun, starting now more than 40 years ago. And this is one example, the best early data on the sun, observed from the South Pole 41 years ago by a French-American group, and showing these oscillation power peaks as a function of frequency here in millihertz, frequency of 3 millihertz corresponds to a period of about 5 minutes, and illustrating this very rich spectrum of oscillations with very well-defined frequencies, which of course is what gives us all the data that we can then use to study the interior of the sun or stars. So this is what we have from the sun, and this is what the kind of data we get from Kepler for distant stars. This is a pair of main sequence stars in a binary system with properties quite close to the sun, a little bit more massive than the sun, frequencies a little bit lower than the sun. And again, you can see these very sharp frequency peaks, allowing very precise determination of the oscillation frequencies. So these are most excited by the acoustic noise. Amplitudes are determined by the balance between the energy inputs from the noise and the damping. The frequencies are high, the last fraction of what we call the acoustic cutoff frequency, the highest frequency of trapped modes in the star. And they are acoustic modes in these main sequence stars. They're high order acoustic modes, and that means that the frequencies are well characterized by the asymptotic behavior of such modes. And that means that the basic frequency spectrum is quite similar to what you see in a musical instrument, with frequencies that are equally spaced in the radial order of the modes. But this is a spherical musical instrument, so frequencies also depend on the degree. So it's a combination of the radial order plus a degree or two, plus a term depending on the reflection at the surface, and then a small correction term. And the frequency spacing, again, is more or less as it would be in the musical instruments. It's the inverse of the sound travel time across the diameter of the instruments. And that then means that we can characterize this by just taking simple frequency differences between adjacent modes in radial order. And if you look at it observationally, this is what we see here in the spectrum. We see this separation between adjacent modes of radial degree zero in this case, and adjacent radial order. And then in between, because we had this L over two, in between the L equal to zero modes, we see an L equal to one modes, L equal to zero, L equal to one. And then the second quantity characterizing this big spectrum is a frequency of maximum power. So you can imagine an envelope describing the power distribution. And that frequency, for some reason we don't understand, is given by the surface gravity of the star and the surface temperature. It's proportional to what we call the acoustic cutoff frequency. So these are quantities we can determine immediately from even fairly basic observations. And they provide measures of the mass and radius of the star because they depend on different combinations of mass and radius. But then if you look at the finer details, we also see that we have this large frequency separation. But then because of this correction term, without that, the modes of degree L equal to zero and two would have the same combinations of N plus L over two, so the same frequency. And the small correction gives a small separation between the modes of degree zero and two. And so that's what we see in the sun and see in main sequence stars. And that's interesting, and you can learn a lot from that, but we want to move on to red giants. And here again, we see these solar-like oscillations. This is just an example of a very short segments of data of red giants in a stellar cluster. Moving up the red giant branch to stars with higher and higher luminosity and bigger radii, and therefore lower and lower frequencies. So we see the same kind of oscillations, but over longer time periods, 2 days, 3 days, 10 days, and 20 days. And if we look at the power spectra, again, we see power spectra that look very similar to what we see in the sun. But in the sun, we had frequencies around 3,000 microhertz. And here we have frequencies going down from 75 to 10 microhertz. Always with the same frequency pattern, always with these very closely spaced frequencies coming, in this case, from modes of degree zero and two, and then one in between. So you could say that's a bit boring. This all looks like main sequence stars. So what's the fun of this? Well, one thing is we can do that for very many stars. And that means we can measure the global properties of all these stars observed by Kepler, the masses and radii, and that's wonderful if you want to study the galaxy, for instance. But also we see that gravity modes, oscillations, G-mode oscillations in these stars. So this is a paper going back almost 10 years. It's a one-page note in Science. And I think this is one of the most important papers that have appeared in stellar astrophysics for a very long time. And let me try to explain that to you. So what we see in main sequence stars again is this pattern of modes of degree 0, 1, between the modes of 0, 2, very close to 0, and maybe 3 if we look very carefully. What we see in a red giant superficially looks very similar. We have modes of degree 0, 0. We have modes of degree 2, very close to that. And then we have modes of degree 1. But instead of just one mode, we see a forest of modes. And actually, if you look very carefully, we can also see a few modes of degree 2. So what's going on here? And what is going on is that we don't just have the radial modes, or the acoustic modes. We also have these different internal standing gravity waves. Now, to understand that, we need a bit more theory. And the critical part here is that the modes are characterized by two characteristic frequencies. One is the acoustic frequency, and this is basically just the frequency of a sound wave with the given degree. And the second is the buoyancy frequency, which is determined by the difference between the adiabatic density gradient and the actual density gradient. Or we can write in terms of temperature gradients, and many of you would recognize these quantities characterizing whether a layer is convectively stable or unstable. So if the temperature gradient is bigger than the adiabatic temperature gradient, we get convective instability. A blob of matter would start to rise and then accelerate. But, and that would correspond to a negative squared buoyancy frequency. If the buoyancy frequency is positive, that blob of matter would start to oscillate up and down around equilibrium. And that is the internal gravity wave. And that is what we see in these stars. Now, the way we see these modes is that if we have a mode with a frequency that's higher than both these two characteristic frequencies, it behaves like an acoustic mode. And if the frequency is below both these frequencies, it behaves like an internal gravity wave, a G mode. In the Sun, this buoyancy frequency is quite low. Its maximum is only a few hundred microhertz, and that's the reason why we just see the acoustic modes. In red giant stars, we have this helium core, which becomes very compact, and that increases the buoyancy frequency to a very high level. To illustrate what happens inside the red giant star, it's very instructive to look at the behavior of different layers in the star with age. This is just a small segment of the evolution of the star as it moves up the red giant branch. Here's the surface of the star, corresponding to a total mass of the star. And what you see is that the surface radius increases dramatically from just more, bigger than one solar radius to almost 100 solar radii. But if you look at the inner layers of star, let's take the 10% of mass point in the star. It starts out at the 10% of the radius, and then with evolution, it contracts to below 1% of the radius. And the same happens to all the inner parts of the star, even a circle radius contracts, or a circle mass contracts to almost 1% of the radius. And so this contraction also drives up the density. The central density of the star increases from a bit more than 1,000 to close to 1,000,000. And that also drives up the internal gravitational acceleration of the star, and therefore drives up the buoyancy frequency of the star. So if you look at the structure of the star, in this case, at a rate of 6 solar radii, we have a region inside the star where the buoyancy frequency is huge. So this is plotted on a logarithmic scale, so we have 10% of the radius here. And here we have a region of this huge buoyancy frequency. Then we have a convection zone that extends over the other 90% of the radius. And here we then have the characteristic frequency of modes, the frequency of maximum power. And so you can see that there's a region inside the star where that mode behaves like an internal gravity wave. And then there's a region in the outer parts of the star where the modes behave like an acoustic mode. We have what's called a mixed mode, a given mode of a star that has basically schizophrenia. It doesn't quite know whether it's a G mode or a P mode. It has a little bit of both. And that means that if we can observe a mode like that on the surface of a star, then the frequencies of that mode reflects also the properties of this inner region, this less than 10% of the radius of the star. And that is what makes these modes so exciting. Now, to characterize these modes, it's also useful to look at what we call the mode inertia. It's basically a measure of the energy of the oscillation at a given surface amplitude. It's an integrate, the displacement, or you could use the velocity, internal velocity of the oscillation, normalized by the surface properties of the star. And if you look at that computed for a stellar model, for radial modes that all behave like acoustically, it just decreases, it's quite small. Most of the energy is close to the surface of the star. It decreases with increasing frequency. But if you look at the dipolar modes, then we can see that for many stars, it's much bigger, many modes, it's much bigger than the radial modes. And then there are these resonances where the star, the energy, the inertia approaches the acoustic value, the radial mode value. And this is where the modes is mostly behaving acoustically. So most of the modes behave, is dominated by the D mode behavior. And a few modes behave acoustically. They resonate acoustically with the outer layer of the star. And the same is true of the quadrupolar modes with degree 2. Most of the modes are G mode dominated, and a few behave like acoustic modes. Now, the G modes also have an asymptotic behavior. For the acoustic modes, we had the frequencies were proportional to the order. For the G modes, the periods are linear in the order, and so they're characterized by a period spacing, which then depends on degree. But basically, we have this uniform spacing of the G modes. And now let's go back to this observation of the radians and a model of that star. So if you look at the model periods of that star and calculate the period spacings, then for most of the modes, we see this constant period spacing. And then for a few cases, we have these resonances where the period spacing goes down, because here the mode is not a purely internal gravity wave. It also has some acoustic property. And now if we look at the period spacings between the modes in this and concentrate just on the dipolar modes in the observed star, we can calculate period spacings between these three modes. We can calculate period spacings between in this group of modes, and we see exactly the same behavior. And the conclusion from that was that what we have here are mixed modes, where the central modes with the highest amplitudes are acoustically dominated, but the other modes here also have some fairly strong G-mode-like behavior. And so we are seeing modes that are sensitive to the structure of the deep interior of the star. And that really is a revolution in our ability to study the internal properties of these stars. And that's the reason why I say that this one-page note, which the editor might have thought was a bit boring since he only made it a note, is actually one of the most important recent papers in stellar astrophysics. So what can we do with this? Well, first of all, we can just look at it graphically, because what we have here is oscillations in the star. It's one mode, but it behaves differently in the core of the star and in the outer layers. It has this mixed character. But also we can learn, use this to find out what's actually going on inside these red giant stars, which we only see as big red balls. And this was another paper that's almost as important and came out quite shortly after the first paper, led by its embedding in Sydney. And what he did was to look at two different red giants. On the surface, they looked more or less the same. More or less the same luminosity, more or less the same radius, more or less the same effective temperature. And I mean, if you look at yet another boring power spectrum, you would say that they look pretty much the same. So what's the excitement here? The excitement comes if you look carefully at the power spectrum, and in particular, look carefully at the dipolar modes. So there's one dipolar mode here, there's dipolar modes here with almost the same frequency. In both cases, you see not one mode, but two, maybe three. And the difference is that in this case, the components of the dipolar modes are quite closely spaced. And down here, they're much more widely spaced. And in terms of these period spacings that I talked about before, we here have an average period spacing for these dipolar modes of 50 seconds. And in this star, a period spacing that's almost twice as big. The acoustic modes, frequency spacings are more or less the same. The stars are very similar, but the period spacings are quite different. And the reason for that is that these stars, the internal structure of stars, is also very different. This is a star that's burning hydrogen in the shell around the helium core, and the helium core is doing nothing. This is a star where there's helium burning in the core and then the hydrogen shell. So this is what's reflected in the oscillations. And the reason for that is actually also fairly simple physically. If we look at the structure of the star in terms of these characteristic frequencies. So here are two models. They're not exactly models of this star, but they illustrate the point. If you look at the acoustic frequencies for two stars, the dashed curves are for the red giant, the solid curve is for the helium burning star. They look very similar. The structure of the outer layers of the stars, of the models, is very similar. But the buoyancy frequency is quite different. The convection zone depth is a bit different. That's also interesting, but not the main point here. The main point is that the buoyancy frequency in the red giant is large all the way to the center of the star. But in the helium burning star, because of the helium burning, the core of the star is convectively unstable. And that means that the buoyancy frequency is zero. And if we then look at the expression we had for the buoyancy frequency, for the period spacing, the period spacing was proportional to the inverse of this integral of the buoyancy frequency. So the buoyancy frequency in the helium burning star is missing all this inner parts. That means that this integral is smaller in the helium burning star, and that means that the period spacing is bigger, and that's exactly what we saw in the observations. And that is the reason why we can use these period spacings to distinguish between core hydrogen burning star, helium burning stars, and stars that just have a hydrogen burning shell. And we can apply that to all these very many stars that have been observed by, the red giant stars have been observed by Kepler. And that is what's done in this diagram. So what is shown here are the stars in the diagram where the horizontal axis, in this case, is a large frequency separation, which again is a measure of the evolution of the star. When it's large, the star has a small radius, it's close to the main sequence. And then as the star evolves, the radius increases, the frequency spacing decreases, and then we move up the red giant branch. And then on the other axis, we have this period spacing. And so here we have the red giants with a fairly small period spacing, like the star in the observations of Tim Bedding we looked at earlier. And then up here, we have the second class of stars, the stars with central helium burning and hydrogen burning in the shell, with these larger period spacings. Now, what's illustrated by the color is the mass of the star. As I mentioned, we can measure the mass of the star from, because we have the frequency separation and we have the frequency at maximum power. And we see that there's no real, we have stars of different masses. Most of the stars are fairly low masses, up to maybe 1.2, 1.3 solar masses. We have a few higher mass stars also, and they're spread all along the red giant branch. In the case of the helium burning stars, what we call the clump stars, we have a clump of low mass stars here, and then we have the higher mass stars, quite a large number of them spread out along what we call the secondary clump. So this also is saying something about different properties of stars in this helium burning phase coming from the different stellar mass. But what you should really notice here is that what we are looking at is a huge star with a radius 5-10 times as big as the sun. And inside that huge star, we have a core, a helium core, which is not much bigger than the Earth. And what we are able to do with the observations is to tell the difference between whether that very tiny helium core is inert, doing nothing, or has nuclear fusion of helium to carbon in the central region. And so if you think back at Eddington's claim and Eddington's quest for finding a tool to look at what happens inside stars, I think this is really a dramatic demonstration of what we can do using astroseismology to look at the interior star. But of course, this is not all. We can also look at how the star rotates. The reason for that is what we see when we look at the star at a mode like this is actually a running wave, a wave that runs around the star. And so the frequencies we observe is basically a combination of the rotation of the star itself, which of course the running wave follows, and then the wave speed, the phase speed of the rotation. And so the frequency we observe is a combination of the intrinsic frequency of the star, of the mode, and then the rotational frequency of the star. And so we can, by looking at this frequency splitting according to the number of waves around the equator, we can measure an average rotation rate of the star. And what we see that in observationally is we see a frequency splitting on top of the fine structure that we looked at before. You might call that a hyperfine structure of stellar oscillations. So if we take these modes here and blow them up, we see these forest of mixed modes. And each of these modes are then again split up by the effect of rotation. And what we can see already here is that the modes that have more G-mode character have a larger splitting than the modes that are more, have a more acoustic character, suggesting that the interior part of the star is rotating more rapidly than the outer layers that dominate the frequencies of this mode. And if you analyze these data, what you find is actually that the core of the star, this helium core, is rotating, in this case, about 10 times as fast as the surface. And again, this is something that we can do for very many stars. We can study how this depends on the properties of the star, the mass, and the radius. And again, we can see that the rotation rate of the core of the star decreases slightly as the star evolves. These are the red giant stars, the stars that have just hydrogen burning shell. These are the clump stars, the stars that are also burning helium at the center, which tend to rotate more slowly in the core. And then we can ask, what would we expect theoretically in these stars? And here we have to think a little bit about angular momentum. And if we take a small part of the star with radius r, then the angular momentum of that part of the star would be the rotation frequency times the square of the radius. And then remember that this part of the star contracts. And so the radius gets smaller, and therefore we'd expect the rotation rate to increase. And again, that's a very dramatic effect. I mean, think of this 10% of the mass of the star, where the radius or the radius decreases by more than a factor of 10. And so we would expect the rotation rate of that part of the star, if there were no exchange of angular momentum, to increase by a factor of 100. And if we look at models of rotation inside stars, then depending on how we start out the rotation rates from the in the early stages of the star, if we start out with a rotation rate of 50 kilometers per second, then we would expect the inner part of the star to rotate extremely rapidly. If we start out more slowly, we would expect a slower rotation of the core. But in all cases, what we found out from the models is a rotation rate that is much, much bigger than what we actually infer from these heliocosmic observations. And so we need some mechanism to transport angular momentum out of the core of the star. And there have been many attempts at modeling that using turbulence or circulation, first driven by rotation, magnetic fields, primordial magnetic fields, maybe dynamo generated magnetic fields, gravity waves, and none of that works. And an example that is shown here, we have, again, for a large number of stars, observed core rotation rates. And in days, rotation rates of the order of a few days, rotation periods of the order of a few days, not varying very much with stellar radius in this case, and then various models of how the rotation rates should evolve if there's no transport of angular momentum. We would expect for these stars a rotation period of 1/100th of a day, about 15 minutes. If we include magnetic effects, we might get a rotation rate or rotation period down to maybe a day. And what we observe is 10 times higher, rotation periods 10 times higher than even these models. And so here we are actually left with a problem that hasn't been solved yet. We still don't know what controls the evolution of rotation in these stars. And that's, of course, something that's being studied very carefully these days. There are ideas of improving the magnetic or modifying the magnetic models that might, in the end, produce rotation rates consistent with observations, but this is still quite uncertain. So again, I mean, we have this very small ball in the middle of these huge stars, the size of the Earth. We can see that that small ball rotates 10 times more slowly than the Earth. We expect that it should be spinning like crazy, and we don't understand why. And again, that's not all, because we can also maybe get an idea about magnetic fields inside this small ball, the small core. And the thing here is finally looking at the amplitudes of these modes and comparing the observed amplitudes of the dipolar modes with the amplitudes of the radial modes. This is what's called the visibility. For, again, a large number of stars, and for most stars, the visibility is more or less the same. We saw that in the power spectrum that I showed earlier. And then there are stars where the visibility of the dipolar modes is much lower than the visibility of the radial modes. And even stars where we don't see any dipolar modes, even though we would expect them to have a very similar amplitude, at least for the acoustically dominated dipolar modes. There's some systematics to this madness. It depends on the mass of the star. Again, we use that we can determine the masses of these stars. For the stars with masses around one solar mass, we don't see any suppressed dipolar modes. For slightly higher masses, we begin to see them. With higher masses still, we see quite a lot of them. And we can actually characterize that by looking at the fraction of stars with these suppressed dipolar modes. And we see that for masses of the order of 1.5 up to 2 solar masses, they span up to about 50% of all the observed stars. And here, Dennis Stello, who led this study, we don't see any for the very low mass stars. And what distinguishes these stars is that on the main sequence, they had a convective core. And so you might say, what does that have to do with what happens on the red giant branch? And the argument there was that if you have a convective core, you have convection, you have rotation, and that might combine to produce a dynamo. In the sun, we think that the surface magnetic field we see in the sunspots is produced by dynamo action coming from the interaction between the solar rotation and the convection in the solar envelope. And similarly, in these stars with convective cores, we might have dynamo action caused by the interaction between the convection and the rotation. And so the guess is that these stars that had convection on the main sequence might actually have a magnetic field in the core So a fossile magnetic field left over from the dynamo action. And that was then used by Fuller et al. To explain these suppressed dipolar modes. And the idea is that you have a mode in the outer part of the star, it penetrates to the core. And there the mode interacts with the magnetic field. And some of the energy is converted to waves. Waves can't get out of the core, they can't get out of the magnetic field. Or they are damped very efficiently. And that means that the dipolar modes, and actually to some extent also the quadrupolar modes, lose energy to this interaction with the dipolar generated magnetic field in the core. And therefore we don't see them. The radial modes, of course, they don't have any special behavior in the core. They're not behaving like G modes in the core. And therefore they don't feel this effect. And so they're not suppressed by this interaction. So again, here we have a very nice idea, which might explain the suppressed dipolar modes. What is shown here is just a sketch. And what now needs to be done is to demonstrate through more detailed modeling that this technique, this mechanism actually works. And again, of course, that's work that's now going on. So this is what we've learned about radii so far. These are some of the open questions that all this work has raised. And so what is next? Well, what is next is, of course, better modeling. There's still a lot we don't understand about these stars. More observations. We still have a lot of data from Kepler we haven't analyzed. We have new data coming in from a mission called CES, launched 2 years ago. And now we are waiting for a mission called PLATO to be launched by ESA, the European Space Agency, in a few years, at the end of 2026, which is going to produce data of the same quality as Kepler for many more stars. And so we have certainly a lot to look forward to in this area. So this was all I had to tell you. So thank you very much. I hope for your attention. Of course, the drawback of this video is that I can't check whether you've been reading your email all along, but thank you very much for being here.
All right, thank you so much, Jørgen. It's a wonderful talk as always. So let me begin. So you can see this question in your chat box.
Well, I can if I close down this, but maybe you should read them out.
I'll just read them out. So Siddharth says to everyone, I have two questions. Do all stars follow the asymptotic theory? What are the possible limitations in this theory? And the second part of the question is there any physical limit to the value of delta nu?
On the first question, the stars we observe using this technique, especially the acoustic modes, tend to be of fairly high radial order. And they do, to a large extent, satisfy the asymptotic relation. But fortunately, not completely, because that means that there's more information contained in the frequency, in the frequencies, than what we get just from the asymptotic quantities. I mean, if they were exactly asymptotic, then all we would learn was the frequency separation and then small departures from that. But departures coming from the fact that the star is not a very regular organ pipe-like structure. And actually, Anvesh Masumdar, who was listening in here, I think, demonstrated that we can see also the effect of sharp features in the stars. The transition from the base of the convection zone to the radiated interior, and also the effect of the helium ionization close to the surface, because that introduces departures from the asymptotics that we can then use to study these parts of the star. And for instance, measure how much helium there is in the outer layers of the star. So these are very important seismic diagnostics. The limits on the last frequency separation, I mean, that depends on the properties of the star. And it's also a matter of observations. That's one reason we have to observe a star with fairly high cadence for the main sequence, because we have these high frequency modes. There's a limit to how high the frequencies can go. At higher frequencies, the modes are no longer trapped by the atmosphere of the star. And so the energy is lost to running waves in the atmosphere, and we don't see the modes.
Okay, there's a next question from Prasad. After looking at the recent experimental evidence for hydrogen fusion through the CNO cycle, allowing us to comment on solar metallicity, any comment on how far a Nature paper from seismic techniques on metallicity, especially given that solar models with low heavy element abundances are not consistent with seismic data? Also,
That's a very interesting question. And one where we don't yet have a definite answer. As you say, the metallicity, the recent metallicity determinations result in solar models that are not in as close agreement with the helioseismic determined solar structure as older models. And so we have an issue there. From seismology, we can try to determine the metallicity, and there have been some attempts directly from the oscillation frequencies. This is somewhat similar to what Anwesh did to determine the helium abundance in the sun and stars. And these results tend to support the low metallicity seen from spectroscopy. But I would say this is still quite uncertain. The neutrino results that came out last week, where we definitely see the CNO neutrinos, of course, are extremely interesting. The results are not yet precise enough to definitely determine whether or not the CNO abundance is high or low in the solar interior. There we probably have to wait for even bigger solar neutrino observations, which are underway, but probably won't give any results for the next 10 years. So we have a problem here with the solar modeling, and of course that's to some extent affects also stellar modeling, although not quite at level where we can see the effects in the models of red giants.
So if any other participants have any other questions, please, you don't have to put it in the chat box, please raise your hand. There's a hand that's raised. Gopu, please go ahead.
Thank you very much for a very nice talk. I don't work on these things. What about the companions racing modes? I mean, especially if they are in non-circular orbit, has been looked into those?
Sorry, what is the planets?
If you have a companion which can raise modes on the stellar oscillation, so those have been looked into?
Oh yes. They are. Mainly for exoplanets, maybe not so much. I mean, the exoplanets in close orbits tend to be all in circular orbits. They have been circularized by tidal interaction, most likely. And so there we don't see any effects, but there are binary stars where we see very strong tidal effects and also see oscillations excited in the primary star, let's say, by these tidal effects. And so that's a very exciting field also. And again, something that provides seismic diagnostics of these stars potentially, although this hasn't been well studied yet. These are different kinds of modes. They tend to be, they are buoyancy modes, or D modes, obviously, a fairly low frequency corresponding to harmonics of the orbital frequency of the stars. And you also, in the Kepler data, see strong effects of the heating. So strong variations in the light of the star associated with the periastron passages. So these are extremely interesting targets. there are stars where the oscillations also seem to be confined to one hemisphere of the star, which is something I don't understand at all. But there's a lot of very interesting work going on with these stars.
Thank you.
I have a question. So you've been so far, I mean, of course, the talk was about red giants, so I requested you to speak about this, very interesting. But in terms of other astroseismic targets, you know, different parts of the HR diagram, what do you think are the most interesting in the future, you know, in terms of missions and so on?
Well, that's very hard to select. In terms of main sequence stars, what we need to work much more on is really the detailed analysis of the Kepler data, because the data are so accurate that we have a chance to observe even fairly fine features of stellar interiors. One very important aspect is to look for effects of mixing in the core of the star, because such mixing from convective core Oshoot in stars a bit more massive than the Sun, because the mixing would affect determination of stellar ages from astroseismology. And the point here is that the astroseismology is also used to characterize stars, host stars in exoplanets or stars in the galaxy. And their age determination is very important, and to make reliable determination of ages of stars, we really need to understand much better how the mixing process is going on in the core of stars. Then there are all the stars that are non-solar-like, where there's also some very, very interesting data. And one class of stars which I would like to look at are what you could call naked red giant stars, namely stars that have lost all the outer envelope but are still in the helium burning phase, where we see, so we just see the core, and there we just see the D-mode oscillations, and maybe from analyzing those data we can learn more about what's actually going on in these cores of red giant stars. So there's some coupling there that would be very interesting. And these are stars that are also observed in great detail by the test missions. So we are getting much more data on these stars. So these very evolved stars, the white dwarfs, are also extremely interesting. So there's a whole zoo there of all kinds of different stars that are being analyzed, and with more data are being accumulated. But for me personally, I think the red giants have really been the high points. Also because I was naive enough to predict that we wouldn't be able to see non-radial oscillations in red giants early on, before the data were really, before the space data came in. And this is one mistake in my research career that I'm extremely happy to have made.
Okay, very good. Other questions from anyone else? Let's just wait about a minute more, a minute longer, and if no one has any questions, then... Okay, I guess nothing else. Thank you so much, Jørgen. Very, very interesting, and we hope to see you in Bombay soon after all of the pandemic lifting. Mm.
Thank you very much. It's been a pleasure.
Thank you.
See you soon.
Be safe. Bye.
Bye.